So hello, I'm Oliver. I work for BlaBlaCar since more than 3 years now. I started as a developer and now I'm a web architect. So yeah.
Okay, and I'm Ben. I'm BlaBlaCar since 1 year and a half as a developer. Okay, so does anybody knows what BlaBlaCar is? Yep. Oh, so still going to present you what BlaBlaCar is. BlaBlaCar is a ride sharing platform where people just talk to each other to find a ride and to share the cost of the travel. Like, if someone wants to spend 120 euros for a trip, he will try to find 3 people to share the cost with him, to make everybody spend 30 euros instead of paying things that he wants.
So everything started in 2005 with this guy, Frédéric Mazella. For Christmas, he wanted to join his family to eat with them, as everybody knows. But all trains were very, very expensive, and he saw a lot of empty cars on the road. So he just asked himself, but why I should create a car sharing website? So the first version started in 2005 and was built with Mambo, which is the ancestor of Joomla, so it's very, very old. It looks like this. As you can see, it's pretty ugly. There is nothing on the website. And it was just a prototype, just to check if everything, if the business model is viable. So as everything seems to be fine, they decided with the other two co-founders to create a real car sharing website. There is a V2, which is in place since 2008, so it's a bit better than the previous one, but it's still not that beautiful. So what is the V2? Oh, and as everything was working fine in France, they decided to open new countries. So as you can see, there is Spain, UK and Italy. And there is a lot of more now, of course, but these two countries were open with V2. They also reached 1 million members with this website, which is not live anymore, of course, but you check it. And of course, this website was far from perfect. There were a lot of problems, and for example, it was in a plain old PHP. PHP 4, of course, otherwise it's not funny. There were a kind of homemade framework. It wasn't really a framework, it was just some classes in there. And for example, there were some files, PHP files, with a lot of lines of code, not that much function, but very, very long functions. And of course, no test. And I suppose you can imagine if you have to update this libtrip, it's really a pain, because it's handle the whole website, the whole everything which is related to trip. So of course, it's really hard to modify something in this class. And as it's not tested, you can be pretty sure that you will have problem in production.
Okay, so given all those facts, we knew at this time that we needed to change everything about the website. So we choose to switch to C22, the framework which was brand new at the time. And why did we choose Symfony? Because we knew it had a huge community in France and the world actually. And because we needed to recruit new people, and people like new stuff, like open source framework, and they don't really like the complex stuff that is only used by you. Okay, so we also needed to use all the best practices we could. Because a huge website like BlaBlaCar cannot go just like running in the wild without any best practice in the place. Okay, so the V3 is the name of the actual website. It looks like that, the .com. Okay, and with the new changes and somebody we also introduced a lot of new tools. We have a staging environment for all the developers. Every time you develop a new feature, it goes in a pre-production environment. And we have staging environment, so we can put everything on it to do some QA tests, some validation, some regression tests, many stuff like that. We also switched to Git, because before we are using SVN. And with Git, we just simplify the workflow like a lot. We have a master branch, and on which we merge everything once it's done. And like, I think every feature to one branch, and then we rebate it, and then we merge it. And after it, we go to the stable one after the test. Okay, so, and for the quality, like, because we didn't have any before, we are using Bamboo to run everything.
Hello?
Yep. Okay, so we are using Bamboo to run everything automatically. All the tests are PHP unit tests, and we have some, a BAT for all the functional tests running on a on an internal BAT launcher written in PHP. Okay.
We also started to use some new tools like Elasticsearch because before this, the whole the web search tricks on the website. The whole web trip search on the website was made in SQL, which is, of course, not made for this. So we switched to Elasticsearch, which is perfect for your use case, because, for example, it handles very well with everything which is related to GeoPoint. So it's pretty cool. Today, we use it, for example, for the trip search, of course, because it's the heart of our business. As you can see, it's really cool because we can add some aggregation on the left and we can factor results by everything we want, so it's really cool. We also use it in the back office. We have the same kind of search but for members. The goal here, this member is a tool which is used by a lot of other tools. For example, everything which is related to fraud detection or to newsletter sending, etc. So we are able to find some members given some some aggregation and some filters. We also use it as soon as you create an alert, for example. So if you want to be notified every time there is a new trip between two cities, you can ask to register to an alert, and we will use Elasticsearch to find all new trips which match your alert. And we also use it with ELK and Kibana, but you will see this tomorrow if you want. We also started to use RabbitMQ a lot. Does everyone know what is RabbitMQ? Okay. For those who don't know, RabbitMQ is a broker, and the goal here is to send some messages to it. And once all messages are posted, you don't have anything to do. You just have to create a new worker which will consume all those messages. We use it a lot. For example, with this kind of worker for with everything related to mail and SMS sending. So every time we want to send an email, we send a message to RabbitMQ, and we have a dedicated worker which consumes this. And as you can see, we have a lot of workers today at BlaBlaCar. And of course, we want to create more and more workers. We also added a reverse proxy because before the video we don't have one. We use Varnish. Today we have 30% of hitmiss, which is not that huge, but we try to improve this. And we also have what we call the fire mode, and it's just like a feature toggle to activate it. And once it's activated, all pages will be cached, and we will be able to serve a lot of more pages than usual. Of course, we use also a lot of other open source tools. As you can see, I'll list some of them here. There is Galera Cluster for everything which is DB related. Redis for mainly for cache. Hadoop for BI. Zabbix for monitoring. New Relic also for monitoring. Chef for everything which is related to infrastructure automation. And Amazon Web Services for some precise need we have. So yeah, as you can see, we use a lot of open source tools, but we also try to contribute to open source. For example, we made Swarot, which is a library to consume messages from AnyBroker. Currently, it works mainly with RabbitMQ because it's the one we use at BlaBlaCar. But you can take a look, it's pretty easy to implement another broker. We also created OpenL10N, which is a translation tool. Open source, of course, you can find it on GitHub. And yeah, it's a really cool tool to be able to translate all your websites in a fancy way. And we also have a lot of other projects. You can take a look at our GitHub. For example, we have more and more projects related to containers because we plan to use Rocket. And yeah, as you can see, there is a lot of open source projects at BlaBlaCar.
Okay, so in the meantime, by doing all this stuff, we still open many new countries. And now I think we have 21 countries open at BlaBlaCar, including India and Mexico. It's quite a lot. But what's happening under the hood of BlaBlaCar? So, for example, we try to follow all the Symfony versions since the 2.0. We update the framework version as soon as we can, like I think when the new version is out, in maybe 2 months' time, we are up to date with it. Every time we have to update the framework, it takes a lot of time because we have to remove all the deprecated stuff, if there is, and to follow the new best practice as long as we can do it. So yeah, we are now in the 2.7, which is the last one, and I think we will follow the new one. Okay, so basically, the website has only one code base, which is available for every country, and it relates on a configuration. Every country has its website, which has a configuration file, in which we have like more than 100 configuration keys that allows us to really customize the website as with many much details that many people don't see, but like what are we going to display on the left, on the right, on the bottom. So it's quite huge to be able to do that. There is of course a fallback default for the configuration, which is I think the English website. And for many websites, we will have to implement a localized version, like because some countries have more than one language, and we have to do the website for many languages, but it will have like an inheritance, like there is a country, then the language of the website. And it's also how we are toggling the feature right now, like if you want, for example, the okay, so it's also how we are toggling the feature for almost all the websites. So it's just a YAML file with many keys, and on the left you have the Spanish one, and on the right the Polish one. It's like I didn't show everything, just some basic stuff, but you have the Google Maps Center, the bounding box for the autocomplete, and many stuff like that are in those files. Okay, so in those files, that's... Hello? Okay. Baguette? Okay, that's where we configured some features. As you can see on the left, it's a Polish website where you can log in with Facebook or your email. And on the left, it's a Mexican website on which you can only connect via Facebook. And it's, I think it's just a key in the configuration, which is put to true, Mexican website. But we also have something that is open source too, which is inspired by the candidate toggle stuff. It allows us to do some on-the-fly changes without doing any deployment. We just have to switch on a web UI. This stuff allows us to declare many features, like okay, we want this to be in, we want the search to be enabled on a website. You can switch it on and off for a specific website, specific users, and many stuff. So it's just an API. We call, as you can see on the right, we have some keys, and we just call it with a class. And on the left, you can see the web UI in which we configure everything for it.
And given all of this, all those changements, we can think, okay, job done. It's cool, you open a lot of new countries, you seem to have a cool product, you have a lot of tools, but in fact, it's not that perfect. For example, in OV3, there is more than 400,000 lines of code, which is not the double of Symfony, but which is a lot of more than Symfony. There is also a lot of commits. The only open source project I found, I didn't search a lot, but it was in Ruby. doesn't matter. We have today nearly 75 contributors on our project. It's not a lot compared to open source projects, but please keep in mind that all those contributors are still at BlaBlaCar and are still contributing every day to this project. So there is a lot of line of code, and there is a lot of people who have to understand all of this works. Today we have a lot of unit tests, but we need near 30 minutes to run them all. And of course we can't do it on our laptop, because to be able to run them all in only 30 minutes, we need to split them in maybe five or six test suites. So it's really, really long to test everything. And of course, we don't test anything because we miss a lot of things. We also need near 30 minutes to deploy the whole application on all servers. Today, I think we have 12 web servers, three servers dedicated to workers, four servers dedicated to the back office, and one machine dedicated to one server dedicated to batch. So we need to deploy the application on maybe 20 machines. It takes a long time, but we need to improve this time, because today we make maybe between 5 and 10 deployments per day, and it takes a long time to deploy. We want to be able to make more and more deployments.
Okay, so what else about the Devisory, as big as it is, it's really long to learn. Whenever someone joins BlaBlaCar, it takes for him maybe, I think, 1 month to really understand how everything works and how not to break anything when he does anything on the website. That's one of the major problems too. Like sometimes you just want to modify a little stuff on the website, and then you break a major feature like the messaging one that has been broken many times. It requires a big maintenance too. Like for each Symfony upgrade, we have to modify a lot of stuff, and there is code everywhere in every possible way. Like there is many, I think, style of code everywhere. It's kind of a mess to maintain. So we decided more than a year ago to try to use microservices at BlaBlaCar. So what are microservices? It's in fact just some little piece of functional code that are going to handle their own stuff. Like you can handle the users, the rating, the notification, and a specific feature like RIMAP, for example. There is a way to implement microservices, which are API. Like you have the website, which is going to call the internal API, that is going to answer you with your awaited response. But at BlaBlaCar, we didn't choose to do it because we don't really like internal API. In PHP, I don't think it's the right way to implement microservices. So no API.
So as we don't use any internal API for now, we decided to create a project which is the gateway. As you can imagine, the goal of this project is to be able to make the gateway, in fact, between our existing B3 and real microservices. And to do this, this project is called, of course. It uses DDD when you need it. You can use it everywhere if you want. For now, everyone in the company loves it, because it does its job, so it's pretty cool. We took a lot of time to decide how we will organize this project, so today it's very well organized. Everything we have a lot of strict rules, so everything takes place in the wrong place. And we decided, yes, to add also a lot of strict rules to be sure that everyone is doing the same things, because we don't want to have 70 different ways of doing something. We also tried to separate business and logic data. In fact, we didn't try, we succeeded, I hope, because our goal to change data backend if we need it. For example, today, for everything related to messages, we switch from SQL to Cassandra. And we want to be able to do this, not always with Cassandra, but we want to be able to change a backend very easily. And it's a vendor, so we can use this project in any other project. Today, I was talking about workers. A lot of them are in a separated project, and they are able to use Gateway because it's a vendor. So you just have to include it in your project, and you're done.
Okay, so I'm going to show you of how we use the Gateway and how to get a rating on the website. Basically, an action on the Gateway is like just a folder which contains many actions like get rating, and we decided to implement it like a web service conversation, but inside the code. You have to make a request and give it to the server, which for us is the handler, and the server is going to give you a response which contains everything you need to your stuff. So the data, it's I think the main part of the Gateway that we like the most. It's the one that can change easily and that can allow us to be really flexible on how we do stuff. So as we can see, we have the interface of the storage. Then for the rating, we have the DBAL storage, which is MySQL, and the Redis one. And that it allows us to be cache ready and backend agnostic, as Olivier said just earlier, which allows us another thing, which is encapsulation. That means that the DBAL storage can contain the Redis one, and allowing us to do simply putting the Redis one inside the DBAL and request first, include first the Redis one, then if the Redis one doesn't contain anything, to use the MySQL to find some stuff. Okay.
So as you can see, I hope it's flexible, because for example, if we want to add some cache on a given storage, we can easily do it by adding a new Redis storage. We can also change easily the backend by adding, I don't know, maybe a Cassandra storage, which will make some app available. It's really easy to test, as every business and all the business part and all the data parts are separated in different folders. Each folder is dedicated to a business part of our work. So it's really easy to take only one part to test it, and then to take another one, etc. Today, we have, maybe more than 1,000 tests on this gateway, and you can run it locally. It's very quick. You need at least, maybe 5 or 6 seconds to run them all. So it's very, very cool to work with the gateway and to test everything. We can deploy it when we need it, when we need. For example, today, I think there is maybe 50 projects which use this gateway. When we update something, we don't update all the projects because a lot of them are using only a small part of the gateway and they don't need to be updated every time. So we only update projects we need. And of course, it's used for all new projects and the goal is to use it more and more. It's a very long task. As Benjamin said, we started to work with it 1 year ago and we still have a lot of effort to make use it everywhere. So just a big picture, this was our previous environment, previous ecosystem. As you can see, it's only the V3. And in the V3, today we still have, in fact, the web pages, the back office tool. We have an API dedicated to mobile. We have the mobile version. We have some workers. So we have a lot of stuff inside this V3. Today with the gateway, we are able to create a lot of new workers or new commands outside this V3. And as you can see, they near all share the same project, which is the gateway. It means you can have different projects with the same business logic, which is very, very good. For now, we don't know how we will work tomorrow. Maybe it will be this. We will have several gateways separated by functional meaning. Maybe there will be one gateway for notification, another one for everything which is related to users, and etc. We don't know yet. Maybe there will be some internal API to join this Zeus gateway. We don't know. Maybe we can split this a bit more, and we can split business and data. And maybe we will have some business project dedicated to users, some dedicated to notification, etc. And we will maybe have the same from the data layer. For now, really, we don't know, but we thought about the gateway. The goal was really to be able to do what we want with it. And today, I hope we will success, and we'll see. So, as you can see, we moved from a homemade framework to a monolith, which was really good stuff, because at the beginning, we were a few developers, and it was really easy for everyone to code in only one project. It was really cool. But now, we are more than 70 developers, I think. So it's really hard for everyone to work on the same project. That's why today, we want to move from this monolith to microservices. And of course, the goal of the company is to keep growing. We still open new countries every year, and we have more and more drivers and passengers. And we think it's simpler to grow with several small applications than with only one big one. That's why we're trying to go to microservices. Yeah, that's all. So if you have any question, feel free to ask them, because I think we were pretty quick. So you have 25 minutes to ask us as many questions as you want, and we have a lot of nerf to give you for your questions. Yes.
It is often said that it is impossible to make microservices without organizing all company in a similar manner. How is your development team organized? How do you approach microservices from the organizational point of view?
We thought we did not have we will not have enough time to talk about it, but I think we have today. There is a lot of small teams which are organized mainly by functionalities. It's not the case for all teams, but for example, there is a team dedicated to payments, and there is some other team dedicated to some functionalities. And today, the goal is to go even further by making a team not only with developers. For example, I think I will let Benjamin answer the end of the question.
Okay, so basically, before 1 month ago, we only had teams with developer and product guys, and since the last month, we have teams with people from all the departments, like a guy from the growth team, a guy from the design team, and many stuff like that, allowing us to really know where we are going and what we are going to do in the next few months. Like that, we can really know what we are going to code and what and how we are going to do it. Allowing us to rethink of the splitting of the code, where we are going to put it in which side of the gateway, which backend, and many stuff like that.
And just to go even further, the goal after I think is to have an architect in all team to make all team independent. And also, in fact, this movement is called micro startups. The goal is to create a lot of micro startups inside BlaBlaCar to make everyone independent. Each team will be in charge of its recruitment, for example. So the goal is to make everyone able to work in small teams and to do what they want.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question about deploy. What tool do you use to deploy? And the second question is, do you have a server for each application in each country? So if you have one code base, if you write a feature for a particular country, do you only deploy to one server, or do you deploy for each server, every server?
For now, we have servers only in France. We have some point of presence in other countries, but all our servers are located in France. And ZV3 is a big problem for this because it's a huge piece of code, and we can deploy everywhere in the world and be able to call a different backend for a different need. That's also why we want to split ZV3. Regarding the deployments, so we deploy the code everywhere, but we are able to activate some functionalities only for some countries, as you saw. And for the deployment, we don't use a given tool. In fact, it's Bash script, which also use Knife, which is a chef tool, to retrieve the list of all servers which needs to have ZV3. So we use Knife to retrieve the list of all web servers, all workers, etc. And then we ask them to update themselves. And each server is in charge of updating itself. And in the future, we are going to use a lot of containers. For now, we are using Rocket. So in the future, the deployment will change a lot. We will be able to deploy containers where we want. And that's also why we want microservices, because it's easier to deploy small piece of code and to deploy them only where it's needed.
Thanks.
Nerf, if you want. Okay, so thank you.